This is MetroSource Minis, the official podcast of MetroSource Magazine and home of short-form interviews with your favorite personalities from the LGBTQ world and beyond. Quick, fun, and informative, it's MetroSource on the go. Out and proud since 1990.
Well, hello, hello, hello. This is MetroSource Minis. I'm your host, Alexander Rodriguez, lead writer for MetroSource and avid podcaster. During COVID, without prides, without the events, a number of us remembered how much we love to eat a lot. So looking for ways to spice up your recipes, we have just the thing for you that comes with a side of history. Today, I am chatting with YouTuber, chef, and soon-to-be author Max Miller, who on his weekly show, Tasting History with Max Miller, gives viewers a look at a historical recipe and explores its origins in a fun and very thorough way. And Max is no stranger to the entertainment industry. His early start was in musical theater and voice acting, and someday you have to hear his Iago. It's fabulous. He would eventually come to work for Disney Studios, but as many people in the film industry, he would find himself furloughed because of COVID. And what was to start as a fun video hobby has turned into a full-time gig with benefits. Tasting History's audience has grown to over hundreds of thousands of subscribers with millions, double-digit millions of views and growing every single day. Max has recently been featured in major outlets that include Today.com, Digital Trends, The Rachel Ray Show, and The New York Post. And of course, we wrote about him in a past issue of MetroSource Magazine, which you can read that article at MetroSource.com. Please welcome Mr. Max Miller.
Thank you for having me. I am thoroughly impressed that you got through all of that without a second take.
I had a little stutter, but you know.
That was amazing.
The powers of a hangover, you know, you're just kind of like lucid and you're just like, okay.
It's a Wednesday, Alexander. It's a Wednesday.
Well, no judging. Any day that ends in the word day is good for me.
Weekdays are a social construct. My cat doesn't know what a Saturday is, so why should I?
Well, and now you kind of in charge of your own business, you know very well there is no day off. There is no kind of time. There's no weekend. You are always working towards the brand. And, you know, we hear a lot of people say, oh, I'm an influencer.
I will never say that.
Well, and you know, true influencers never say I'm an influencer. It's like if somebody has to say I'm very classy or I'm very funny, truth is probably not.
Yeah. Well, I always thought that was kind of weird too, because if you're an influencer, like that should be secondary to what you're actually doing that made you be an influencer. So tell people that you are a chef or an actor or a content creator or whatever. Don't tell them you're an influencer. I don't know. I don't like it. I don't like it at all.
So you are a chef who is a YouTube star. Let's put it that way. But you're actually a YouTube star. At what point did you kind of realize that your YouTube videos were really, really taking off?
It was about a year ago. A year ago last week, I had a video go up and first few days, it did as it usually does, you know, 300 or 400 views. My friends and family were watching. And then overnight, 20,000 views, 70,000 views, 150,000 views. And it hit 1 million views, I think, or close to it within that week. And I went from a few thousand subscribers to 150,000 subscribers in 5 days. And then when I really, though, knew that it was something was when when the subsequent videos kept doing well, because there are a lot of channels where they'll have a video go viral,
right?
But they don't know why necessarily. I still don't know why exactly, but their next video doesn't capture the same audience or whatever. So people, you know, that one video is kind of an outlier, but and that one video even for me is still an outlier, but it kept trekking and moving up. So about a month later, I was like, maybe I got something here.
Well, I have to say, you know, my opinion on that is it all comes from sincerity. I think videos that people really connect with, it has to come from a very real place. And so when somebody has a video that goes viral, I think the tendency is to try super hard and to overdo it for the next one. Right. And what I love about your channel, because I'm a huge fan, is you have kept that integrity, that storytelling, that personality. You know, some of the bells and whistles have changed and, you know, gotten even better. But the essence is still the same. We still feel this like intimate relationship that you're just talking to us about history and having a really good time doing it, but you've been able to kind of maintain this energy. But what kind of pressure does it take for you to keep looking at the views and the subscribers? Cause now it's actually your business. It's just not like, oh, it's nice to have these followers. This is your business.
Yeah. It's exhausting. You know, I mean, it's a lot to put out new content, but it is exhausting to follow the view count, follow the subs as they grow, especially because subscribers, honestly, it's a vanity number. It doesn't matter how many subscribers you have. I know channels with 200,000, but they get 1 million views on each video. And then I know ones with 3 million subscribers getting 50,000 views on each video. Well, guess who's actually doing better? It's all about the views. But it's a vanity number that you still follow because you want that gold plaque or whatever. What's disappointing in what I find disappointing in myself is that my mood, especially on a Tuesday, hinges on how well that video that I released that Tuesday did. And I try not to let that happen, but it does. And it's just like, gotta get over it, especially because it's not fair to Jose, my fiance. It's like, I'm gonna be in a bad mood all day because this video didn't do as well as the last few.
But you know, this is the reality, and thank you for sharing that. This is the reality of what people on social media or on YouTube have to go through. It's not all the glitz and the glamour. It's not all the fun. And I kind of want to talk to you about being furloughed from Disney. You know, there must have been a period of time where it was like, oh crap. I know a lot of us in the industry suffered depression. And you kind of took that time to kind of reinvent yourself on something that you were not doing before. Talk to me about how you kind of got through that initial news of I'm furloughed, what next?
Well, it was a complete lockdown of spending money, I had actually like bought the camera and the microphone before I was furloughed. And thank goodness I did, because I would not have bought anything once I was furloughed. But it also made it so for a little while, the videos were, what do I have in my kitchen? And I will find an old recipe that uses those things, especially because it was hard to find most ingredients at the time. You know, even finding flour was difficult in those first couple of months.
Right. But
I had that shortage. Yeah, it was crazy. I did get quite depressed, and my videos didn't take nearly as much work back then. They were a lot shorter. They were easier. I was always talking about stuff that I already knew about, so there wasn't a lot of research to do. And that left me with a lot of time to sit in my bed and watch British TV all day long while my fiance was still working. And after about a month of that, he was kind of like, you should really not do that anymore. And so I started doing more than one video a week for a couple weeks and quickly found out that wasn't doable, but it did get me out of that rut. And I was like, I'm going to focus on this. And luckily, you know, I had unemployment, so I wasn't dying or anything, but it was rough those first few months for everyone.
I think the message is, you know, keep going. And if you have a passion, you know, don't stop, you know, focus on that passion. And when we talk about tasting history, it actually doesn't come from a passion from being a cook or a chef from like your childhood. It's not like that.
No.
Your passion came from history.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't even think of it as a cooking show. I think of it as a history show that has cooking on it. Food is a way into the story for me, because history, if taught well, I think, is all about stories. You know, you shouldn't be able to tell a history from a fiction book like Game of Thrones, except for the dragons, could basically be history. So that's what I've always loved. And I only recently, 6 or 7 years ago, got into baking and kind of made that connection. So the history I feel confident about each week, the cooking I fumble my way through the kitchen.
I think that's fun, though, because it kind of challenges, like, hey, you know, I can do this, too, or I can try and just make an attempt and have a really good time.
Yeah.
Now, what is it about history that you love so much, and what do you think we can learn by focusing on history?
You know, I have always loved it because I've always been able to put myself in the shoes of whatever historical person I'm talking about or reading about or whatever. And it all started actually from my grandfather, who would tell me stories about his time in World War II in Germany and France. And because he was my grandfather, I could picture him in those places. Granted, I was always picturing him as this 70-year-old man, you know, fighting the Nazis.
Right. Yeah.
Not a 20-year-old man. But at least I was able to make that immediate connection. It wasn't foreign. And I've always been able to take that connection to 500 years ago, 2000 years ago. It's like, I can picture myself there. And so it's just like reading a choose your own adventure book, you know? And there's just so much of it. There's so much history. You're never going to run out. So it's, I don't know. I love it. I just love it. I love about it.
Well, no, it's exciting. And I think, you know, we got bored of all the Netflix shows. And I think a large number of us, myself included, started watching the great documentaries that had been available to us, even from the LGBTQ history, but world history. And so I think there's a younger generation that has been exposed to this. And, you know, I think it's very in right now. And I think it's so important. Now, take us through the creative process of creating a video. How do you choose what food to make? How do you do your research? And do you do a sample before you put it on camera?
Sometimes. So it usually starts with a recipe. And then I'll find the history after that. It's harder to find history of a food and then try to find a historic recipe because 99.9% of foods do not have historic recipes, you know. So I try to start with the recipe and then kind of figure out how to cook it. And sometimes I do full tests, sometimes I test just little bits. And then I start researching, and that's always my favorite part, but it's also the most time consuming part. It can take 20 or 30 hours, depending on the topic. But I usually start with Wikipedia, but then that gets into scholarly works. If you go down and find out, you know, where is Wikipedia getting its stuff? And then those scholarly works in their bibliography have primary sources, actually writings from the ancient Romans or whatever. And that's where I always find my gold. Half of my episodes are usually quotes from, you know, old authors and the people who are actually living the history. And that's what I mean by like putting yourself in their shoes. It's so much easier to do that when you're listening to their words as opposed to listening to a historian just talk about it. And so that's what I really focus on. And then I usually will make the very often that dish that's in the episode is the first time that I've made it in full. And it's almost always the first time that I've tasted it on camera. The only time that I'll taste it beforehand is if it's something that it needs to be eaten within the first 5 or 6 minutes that it's out of the oven or whatever, because by the time I get it to the table and clean everything up and have the camera going and everything, it's often been like 3 hours. So whatever I'm eating is rather old at that point. You know, I could stick it in the microwave, but I usually will have tasted it right when it finished. And I always have my fiance taste it because his opinions are, he'll tell you what he thinks and he'll gladly tell me what I think. So, but that's good. It's like, no. So. That's how it goes.
What I have to tell you, what I also love about watching your videos is I love reading the comments in each video because people will talk about their own recipes from their own family region, depending on what region you're focusing on, or scholars in a very certain region that you're talking about or a certain part of history will also chime in. And it becomes this conversation with your fans, with each other, about history and family stories and tradition. And so that's equally as exciting for me. And so Little Bird told me you're actually working on a cookbook.
I am. Yeah, I have a cookbook. It's going to be published by Simon & Schuster. I'm working on writing it now. And it's, you know, it takes so long, not just to write it, but even once it's done, to get it published is like, takes like a year. So it's going to be a little while before it hits shelves. But it's really exciting just to, you know, think that even when I'm done with YouTube and there will be a book, and you know that can't be taken away from me. So that's going to be.
And then
exciting.
The TV show's going to follow, and then you know,
the movie.
Who would you cast as you in your movie?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. A young Brad Pitt. Can I choose a young Brad Pitt? Does it have to be crazy Brad Pitt? Or Zac Efron? I'll take Zac Efron.
There you go. Put him in there. You just nailed it. Yep. And he's got this rough going too.
Any age. Yeah.
So let's talk a little about your relationship. You know, your channel didn't start out, and it isn't. It's not a gay show. It's not a gay channel per se. And I think that's the conversation that we're really getting in today's day and age is, you know, being gay is a part of our full puzzle. You know, we're so many things. Yeah. Just like you're not an influencer first, you're a chef first. And so what I love about that is that, yes, you are a part of the LGBTQ community. You're a spokesperson for a community. Because you live your life and you share your relationship, you share moments with your fiance.
Yep.
But we know how many hours this takes. And we know now, like with the media that you're doing and now working on a cookbook, how does this play with your relationship? Because your time is very different. The stress you're under is very different. So how do you maintain a healthy relationship while keeping up this busy job?
I mean, he's also really busy, but I also think he's extremely understanding of like when I can't do anything or when I'm just too tired or whatever. But every single night, even if it's just for 45 minutes before I go to bed, we sit down, watch TV together. And it's just that, you know, even that quick bit of time together is always fun. But he also contributes to the channel. Not so much in like, he's not writing or editing it, but he works on doing comments and he has the subtitles and those little things there. He's part of the conversation and people know him. So the channel has kind of become a little bit, it is our relationship in a way. Probably not healthy. But then there's also, we have like made a concerted effort. This weekend, we're going to Seattle for a few days. Mm-hmm. We made a concerted effort to, once a month or so, take 2 or 3 days away from the channel, away from home, and, you know, have time that's not tasting history.
I think that's so important. And even, you know, for those solo content creators out there, even just taking time to yourself, you know, if you're not in a relationship, it's so important to not lose that aspect, because you can get wrapped up, you know, in this job. And then, you know, you're just exhausted and mentally drained. What I love to see about you and Jose is the support you have for each other. You know, the comments on each other's social media, the little gifts that you give each other, and just really being there for each other. It's very heartwarming. Now, what kind of food are you going to be serving at the wedding?
Well, it's all going to depend on what's open. So we're going to Hawaii for the wedding. And right now, you still can't have more than, I think it's 6 people at like a table at a restaurant. So we were going to do a restaurant, and maybe we still will. And in that case, I want kind of like traditional Hawaiian food, because that's what I like that. And we're going to be in Hawaii. But if we end up having to like do a catered thing, get a big Airbnb, there are only 20 of us, then I don't know what it's going to be, but probably Hawaiian food. It's not going to be anything like historical, other than they've been making a certain dish for hundreds of years or whatever.
Right.
Nobody wants that at their wedding.
Well, just so you know, Max, I am a registered officiant.
Come on to Oahu, baby.
All right, this one is for social media. What is the easiest kind of recipe to do with a good story that somebody like me could serve on a first date and impress somebody, but still be able to do it.
When you said still be able to do it, I wasn't exactly sure what you...
Oh! No Chipotle.
Stop. Syllabub is the answer. It's the easiest thing that I've ever made on the channel, and it's one of my favorites. It's basically just whipped cream with alcohol in it.
Oh,
it was really popular in the 1600s and 1700s. I mean, alcoholic whipped cream. And you can kind of flavor it however you want and put different alcohols, whether it's sherry or other wine or port, or have had people make it with sake and soju. It's versatile and delicious and super easy. And you can make it in like 8 minutes.
I love that. I'm going to do that. You know, now that we're dating again, I'm definitely going to do that. Max, I love chatting with you every moment I get. And, you know, I just love watching your channel to see the channel just grow and all the different kinds of foods and people that you're talking about. It's definitely a learning experience for me. So thank you so much for sharing that with the world.
Thank you, Alexander.
Tell everybody where you want them to find you and follow you.
YouTube.com/tastinghistory is where you're going to see all my stuff. But I'm also pretty active on Instagram, Tasting History with Max Miller.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And happy Pride, by the way.
Thank you. Yes, it's almost over. Ah,
yeah. Tell
one
Jose
more day
I
to
said,
be proud.
Tell Jose I said hello.
I absolutely will.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
That has been my chat with Max Miller. Like I said, I just love chatting with him. You can read my in-depth chat with him at metrosource.com, and he actually has that recipe there as well. So anybody can do it. And that's our episode. I'm your host and lead writer for Metrosource Magazine, Alexander Rodriguez. You can follow me on Instagram at AlexanderIsOnAir. Until next time, stay true and do you, boo.
That has been another Metrosource Mini. Like, share, and subscribe on your favorite podcast player, and check out the latest issue of Metrosource Magazine on newsstands or online at metrosource.com. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram at Metrosource, and on Twitter at Metrosource Mag. Until next time, stay fabulous.